Hey everyone, John here. Welcome back to another Sapphire tutorial. This time we're going to take a look at Sapphire's PixelMosh effect and how you can use it to give your text and logos a beautiful glitchy grungy look. So go ahead, download the After Effects project file and let's take a look. All right, so here in the composition, I've got this text and logos comp. So if you've got the project in front of you, just double click that. In here, we've got some text. And we've got the Boris effects logo, and we've also got the Sapphire logo. So just a couple of things we can test PixelMosh with. So we'll start with text. Now, back in the main comp, this is selected. So let's apply PixelMosh. And if you look at this and think, man, that looks complicated, you're not alone. Because when I look at this, especially the first time I looked at it, I thought, wow, you know, where do I start? And I'll say it, like I've said it with all Sapphire effects, start with a preset, and that way you get an idea about how the effect can be used. Now, having said that, when you're working with text and not footage, or when you're working with logos as well, it's actually a much more simplified effect. There's only a few parameters that you need to work with, and that's because when you're working with text and logos, you use the alt flow data setting, okay? And I asked David, our engineer, our Sapphire engineer, how to describe alt flow data. And he said to me that basically alt flow data gives you the final result of a custom optical flow calculation. So what that means is that by using alt flow data, you're basically bypassing 99% of these settings. There's only a few settings that you need to deal with, which is making this effect much easier to use. So before we apply alt flow data, let's go into this maps composition. Because this is my alt flow data comp. So I've just called it maps because I often call, you know, displacement maps and that sort of thing maps. So in here, I've got some footage because you'll often use footage as alt flow data. But I've also got a couple of Sapphire S Effect presets. These are directly from the preset browser. And there's a sort of curvy one there, more organic. This is a kind of a glitchy one with a lot of black. And we've got this one too. And I like this one because it's got a lot of fine detail, this sort of use of grid in here. So you can go ahead and use Sapphire Effect, specifically Sapphire Effect presets as sources for your PixelMosh, which is exactly what I've done here. So we'll see how these different kinds of presets affect the PixelMosh look. So let's go back to main and we'll come up to PixelMosh. Now I've got my default settings in here and at the moment nothing's happening because we have to choose our alt flow data source. So I'm going to choose maps. And you just saw a little bit of offset there, right? Remember the first map, the first alt source data source is that fire. So the fire is sort of wiping across. And if you ever want to see what the footage looks like, come down to show here and show flow. So there it is. That's what's being used as the alt flow source, okay? All right, so with that applied, let's take a look at the settings that actually affect the alt flow source. And there's only a few of them. We've got alt flow data scale. So bringing that up, you'll see we get a much stronger result. As I drag that up, we get more and more distortion. You can see how the fire is moving through the text like that. And PixelMosh distortion is great. It's a much more organic distortion than, say, something like digital damage would give you, which is more angular. So there's alt flow data scale. And we have block size X and Y. So coming up really big will give you bigger blocks. So a more sort of fractured look. And going really small gives you a much more granular look. I bring that right down. We get a lot more detail. Just like that. I'm just going to reset those. And the next one is flow warp scale. And if we bring that up, this scales the amount of warp distortion. So if you really want to destroy your text or logo, bring this up nice and high. Well, I've only got it at 6 there and it's already, you know, it's already almost unreadable. So those are the key things. Alt flow data scale, block size X and Y, and flow warp scale. Just four things to think about when you're working with text and logos. I'm going to reset that and just bring up the alt flow data scale. Also got to just choose my alternate source again. Now, the other thing that can also affect this is a mask. So I'm just going to draw a mask on this like that. And I'll just turn it off by hitting M. Actually, I need to have a look at my mask settings here and choose none. And up here in the effects, I'm going to choose as my mask from path, mask one. So there you can see the pixel flow is only affecting the area inside the mask. Now, if we come down and we blur the mask, take a look at that. So as I bring that value right up, we're getting more and more blur inside and we're getting less of an effect here. And we get this kind of ghosting effect, which is quite an interesting look. Like a double exposure. So you can use masking with alt flow data source as well. All right, so those are the basics. Let's come up to this one now. And as I always do, I was experimenting and thinking, why settle for one pixel mosh when you could have more than one? So what I've done here is I've actually used two pixel mosh effects. Let's just turn the second one off. So this is the first one, basically the same setup as we just looked at. So we've got a S pixel mosh effect. And for this one, we're not using any masking, okay? So the masking is turned off. Notice how in block size X and Y, Y is at zero. So that's actually quite a nice look as well. Just make either the X or the Y zero. So we're getting this kind of look. And as I obviously move down the timeline, I'm using different map sources. You see how that one at the very end, the one with the grid, adds that sort of, you know, stripy detail. So obviously different flow sources will give you different looks. Let's just go into the text and logos and let's try the Boris effects logo. Okay, come back to here. So we've got our first pixel mosh effect, but what about if we use a second one? So by turning on the second one and just noticing here that I'm using mask from path mask one, we're actually applying this over the top of that one with a bit of masking. So we've got that sort of soft double exposure look, and obviously change the settings here, much smaller block X size or block size X. So we're getting almost a smoky kind of distortion. So sort of combining, you know, a more angular look with a larger block size, with a smaller block size. And with one of them using mask and one of them not. But they're both using the same alternate flow data source. So you can see you can really get some interesting looks. Notice how with that much smaller size for X, we get a lot more detail as well. So the smaller the block size, the more detail from the source you'll see in the distortion. Really nice. And the last composition was just me sort of playing around with different Sapphire time effects. If we come into here, just do a quick preview. I've already done a quick pre-render of this. So this is giving you an idea about what it looks like with a couple of the different Sapphire time effects. So the first one here is Sapphire's Time Warp RGB. So it's exactly the same as the other composition, these two pixel mosh effects, but just with Time Warp RGB applied to it. Check that out. That's really nice. It gives you that RGB split. The next one is Sapphire Trails. And here I've used for the new color just this yellow. And you can see how as it distorts, it introduces that new color. I've only got a couple of steps here, and when it creates the new steps, it just colorizes those to yellow, which is really nice. And obviously, pixel mosh is already quite random, depending on your alt flow source. But if you want to make it even more random, you can use effects like Sapphire Random Edits. So that basically jumps around the timeline and chooses frames. So you can see how that's much more glitchy. And a similar one to that is Sapphire's jitter frame, which is also taking random frames. And I just spent a couple of minutes applying different time effects, and I was surprised with the looks that I was coming up with. But I definitely recommend going in and trying other different Sapphire effects and see what you can come up with when you apply it after PixelMosh. All right, so why don't we finish off now by looking at how you could set this look up inside of Sapphire Effect to create your own custom effect. So we'll go back to the main comp. And why don't we do this? We'll switch off that one. Let's duplicate this one. Just bring it up to the top. And we'll get rid of both of the PixelMosh effects. What we'll also do just for now is take a look at the Sapphire logo. It hasn't had any love. So we'll just turn that on. Come back to main. And let's get rid of the mask as well. Okay, so we'll apply Sapphire S effect. And let's edit effect. And here inside of the builder, there's our logo. So let's load PixelMosh just by hitting tab, typing in Pixel M, double click. And notice here we have a port for alt flow data. So let's load a Sapphire effect for that. Since we use a Sapphire effect in After Effects directly, I'm just going to choose this one, 80s glass warp. It doesn't have to be an S effect effect. You could use single Sapphire effects as long as it has pixels. Click load. That's going to drop it here into the workspace. Now we don't need ultra glow. It's not going to affect the final look. Neither is emboss shiny. We'll grab that and we'll just link it into the alt flow data port. Click on PixelMosh and make sure you've got preview selected node selected. All right, so we can't see much. Remember, the default setting is very subtle. So let's just increase the alt flow data scale and the flow warp scale. And because we want to make a custom effect in our host, and I'm using After Effects, of course, but you can use this in any host that supports Sapphire Builder. We want to only view the parameters that we feel that are needed inside the host. So obviously, when we're working with text and logos with PixelMosh, that's going to be alt flow data scale, block size, and flow warp scale, and blur mask. We'll have those on. Let's also just select these ones and just click and click just to turn everything off. They've already been customized. That's why some of them are turned off, because this was a preset. So click, click, turn it off. We don't want to see these inside the host, but we can always come back to S effect and change those. And last but not least, if we want to mask this, a good way to do that is to use Sapphire Shape. So I'm just going to hit tab, type in shape, double click, and I don't need it in the source hierarchy. So I'm just going to disconnect, and I could load a preset, of course, but this is just for demonstration purposes. Just port it into the mask port, and it's starting to mask that off. So if I want to soften that a little bit, of course I can blur that, just like we looked at directly in After Effects. So once that's done, just deselecting all of those, you can save that as a preset, Control S, give it a name and save it, and you can use that later or share it with other builder users. It's going to cancel that. Click OK. And over here in After Effects, there's the custom parameters. So it's much more simplified and easier to use. All right, so hopefully that's demystified PixelMosh a bit for you, at least when using it with text and logos. As you can see, it's very straightforward and very effective. To learn more about Sapphire or to download a trial version, be sure to visit borisfx.com. But for now, this is John. I'll see you in the next tutorial.